TSADIYQ? Never heard of it? Well, stay tuned. You are about to discover that TSADIYQ is a beautiful Hebrew word which has so much more depth than some of our English translations of TSADIYQ have been able to reveal to us. But first, let me remind you, friends, the mystery, which is the love we call God, is with you all. Thanks be to all that is holy. Welcome to our summer worship series, Words of the Word. My name is Dawn Hutchings, and I am privileged to serve as the pastor at Holy Cross. Holy Cross is an inclusive community which is progressive in approach and Christlike in action. Words of the Word is our summer theme, and each week our worship will be inspired by a word which reveals something about the Word. The Word has been used by Christians to express the divine mystery itself. You'll remember the Word from the opening poem in the Gospel attributed to John. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Today, we are going to explore the Greek word TSADIYQ, which most of our English Bibles only translate as righteousness. I don't know about you, but righteousness is one of those churchy words which leaves a bad taste in my mouth. Fortunately, there is more to TSADIYQ than the word righteousness would lead us to believe. So I'm delighted to welcome you to worship, and I trust that in the word TSADIYQ, the one who is the word itself speaks to you. As we worship together, let us remember we worship as we live, in the presence of the one who is beyond the beyond and beyond that also, our lover, beloved, and love herself. Amen. Let us open ourselves for prayer to the one in which we live and move and have our being, the one who is love, love living in, with, through, and beyond us. Let us be disturbed by the timidity of our desires for justice. Let our failure to dream big when it comes to loving our neighbors disturb us. Let our inability to see beyond our fears disturb us. Let our willingness to settle for the status quo disturb us. Let our swift retreats from the struggle for justice disturb us. Let our acceptance, our avoidance, and our denials of the horrors of our neighbor's pain and suffering disturb us. Let our endless reluctance to change our privileged lifestyles disturb us. Disturbed by our call to be love in the world, may we be transformed by love to become justice seekers and peace makers. Let us breathe deeply of our shared spirit so that the power of the love which is divinity continues to work in, with, through, and beyond us to ensure that justice flows like a river and righteousness flows like an unfailing stream. Let it be so among us, through us, and beyond us, now and always. Amen. Thank you. Years ago, when I was in the business of developing package holiday tours, I traveled on a junket to the city of Lima, which was sponsored by the government of Peru. The Peruvian government tourist office was trying to convince the travel industry that Lima was about to become the hottest destination for North Americans. I had never been to Peru before, but based on what I knew of the conditions in Peru, I strongly doubted that Canadians would be flocking there in great numbers. The now defunct Canadian Pacific Airways had just opened up a new air route to Lima, and it was my job to put together holiday packages for the airline. These government-sponsored tours are designed to showcase a destination in its best light. So I was not surprised when we were quickly hustled out of the airport in luxurious limousines and taken to the best hotel in the city. That night, after a magnificent meal, we were briefed by the government tourism officials on what we could expect to find in the streets of Lima. During the course of our briefing, we were warned that from time to time during our stay, we would undoubtedly run into the odd beggar or two. The odd beggar or two, that phrase struck me as odd at the time, but now it fills me with shame as I remember passively listening without comment. We were instructed not to let these beggars bother us. We were assured that many of them weren't nearly as bad off as they looked, and that we shouldn't allow them to play on our sympathies or spoil our stay in Lima. According to our guide, begging was a way of life for most of the people who lived on the streets, and if we showed them any courtesy, they would only take advantage of us. We were also warned to leave our valuables in the hotel safe. Wearing jewelry of any kind was strongly discouraged by our government guides. The next morning, as we prepared for our sightseeing tour, my assistant John and I, we dutifully deposited our valuables in the hotel safe. Before we left the hotel, John, who'd been on a few of these junkets with me in the past, asked me if I had enough change. John knew that our guide's instructions about giving money to beggars would have, as usual, fallen on deaf ears. John didn't like the idea that no matter where we were, if someone asked me for a handout, I always tried to oblige. John insisted that giving money to beggars sends out the wrong signal. He insisted that if you give money to one, then you'll have to give money to all of them. And there's no way that you can solve a beggar's problems with a few coins, let alone deal with the problems of all the beggars who'll jump on the gravy train. John and I had long since stopped arguing about whether or not to give to beggars. We'd worked together for a long time, and we'd agreed to disagree. Besides, I was his boss, so rather than try to argue with me, John just sort of looked out for me and tried to make sure I didn't get myself into too much trouble. I had assured John that I had enough small change to see us through the morning. But I wasn't prepared for the onslaught from the homeless children of Peru. It only took about 10 minutes before my pockets were empty. And when I ran out of coins, I was stunned when John took over where I left off. In the past, John had always managed to stick to his guns, but these kids somehow managed to get to him. It's difficult for North Americans to understand how small children can be allowed to roam the streets. The poverty is beyond comprehension. I don't remember much about the city of Lima. I couldn't tell you anything about the tourist attractions which we visited, but I can still remember the pain and the desperation in the eyes of the children which we encountered. At lunch, John and I filled our pockets with leftover bread and bits of cheese, which we gave to the children who accosted us outside of the restaurant. John kept blaming me for starting something that we had no hope of finishing. But despite his insistence that we adopt a tougher stance, it was John who hustled over to the shop across the street and bought several loaves of bread, which he distributed to a small band of kids who followed us the rest of the afternoon. As we headed back to our hotel, I think both John and I took some consolation in the knowledge that for at least a few hours, the little band of kids who were following us had food in their bellies. We were discussing the relative merits of buying these kids dinner when a boy, who couldn't have been more than about 10 years old, came around the corner and blocked our way. Before John could do or say anything, the boy grabbed me by the arm. And John was about to reach for the boy's shoulder, but something in the boy's appearance stunned John into stillness. The oozing sores which covered most of the boy's face were revolting. It was as though the child was actually rotting before our very eyes. Before John or I could recover from the horror of being in such close proximity to septic human flesh, the boy reached for the silver necklace which hung around my neck. I had tucked the silver cross which hung around my neck inside my shirt so as not to attract attention to it. But as the boy took hold of the chain, the cross was revealed. The boy hesitated for just a moment, and the two of us exchanged a glance which contained such sorrow. And then, in a flash, the boy, the chain, and the silver cross were gone. I wasn't too upset at the loss of a cheap silver chain, and the cross was something which I had picked up in a flea market in London, so all in all, I wasn't out more than about 20 bucks or so. But John, he was livid. He was furious, and nothing I could do or say would calm him down. What upset John the most was his conviction that by stealing a cross, the boy had somehow crossed a line which was unforgivable. As John saw it, the moment of hesitation meant that the boy actually knew what the cross represented, and then he stole it anyway. Peru is a largely Roman Catholic country, and as John saw it, this kid had to know that what he was doing was wrong. The fact that this kid might have been starving wasn't any kind of excuse as far as John could see. In John's world, some lines should never be crossed, no matter how desperate you are. Word of our altercation on the streets of Lima eventually got back to our government guide, Mano, who tried to understand John's indignation over the theft of a cross, but somehow Mano's heart just wasn't in it. Mano did his best to explain the desperation of the children who live on the streets. But when John's anger could not be consoled, Mano asked us if we'd like to see where most of these kids come from. So the next morning, Mano took John and I to a landfill just outside of Lima. There, in the garbage of the city, was a world I shall never forget. Men, women, and children living and dying in the decay of the filth of the city. Children, toddlers, poking around in the garbage, trying to find something to eat. The smell and the stench of the steaming, rotting garbage was indistinguishable from the smell and the stench of the rotting children. In that stinking mess, we saw things which still have the power to cause me to weep. John, without speaking a word, began to empty his pockets, but there was no way that he could even begin to make a dent in the need. By the time we returned to the car, we had quite a following. With no more cash left, we were desperate to get out of there. And yet, surrounded by such human need and overwhelmed by human stench, we stood by the car, paralyzed by our despair. Mano encouraged us to just get in the car, but we stood there and we listened as children tugged at our clothing and begged us. They tried to get us to give them something, anything, which would help them to survive. It was then that John took off the gold chain which hung around his neck. I couldn't help noticing the gold cross which hung from that chain. And John reached out to the littlest of the boys, and he placed that treasure, that gold cross, in that little boy's hand. Neither of us said a word on our way back to the hotel. It wasn't until about 3 weeks after we returned home that we actually talked to each other about our experience. John was having a difficult time reconciling what he did for a living with the weight of human need. Somehow, helping to organize holidays for wealthy North Americans just wasn't enough for him anymore. 6 months later, John enrolled in Teachers College. He can't help all of the children, but he can and he does help wherever and whenever he can. John is a righteous man. For years, the well-known phrase in the book of the prophet Amos has annoyed me. According to the story, Amos hears the annoyed voice of Yahweh say, "Spare me the racket of your chanting, relieve me the strumming of your harps. Instead, let justice flow down like a river and righteousness flow like an unfailing stream." I could always relate to the longing to let justice flow. But righteousness was something I had little or no appetite for. In my mind, the idea of righteousness was always associated with the holier-than-thou crowd of self-righteous religious types. I had no desire to see righteousness flowing like an unending stream. The wisdom of our Hebrew ancestors was hidden from me by the limited translations which I had always been offered of the Hebrew word TSADIYQ. The common way our English word righteousness has come to be understood fails to capture the rich meanings of TSADIYQ. In Hebrew, and indeed in modern Judaism, TSADIYQ goes so much deeper than mere righteousness. TSADIYQ is a way of being in the world which embodies the love which is the divine mystery we call God. For to practice TSADIYQ is to seek ways of helping people in need. TSADIYQ is to be generous with your time and your resources. TSADIYQ is to be charitable. TSADIYQ, to be known not for your religious piety or self-righteous concerns, but to be famous for outrageous acts of generosity, kindness, and indeed charity. Charity, the word itself, is an old English word which comes from the Latin Vulgate's translation of the Greek word agape, which means love. To be TSADIYQ is to be love in the world. When I think of my old friend John's outrageous act of charity, I know full well that his momentary act of desperation was irrational, and in the end it probably did very little to change much of anything by the world's standards. It could even be argued that it would be perfectly reasonable for me to respond with self-righteous indignation, considering John's initial reaction to my own feeble attempts to respond to suffering. Over the years, I have heard all sorts of reasonable, some might even say righteous, arguments about why charity is futile. Many of us will refuse to give charity, arguing that we must get to the very heart of the matter and solve the problems behind suffering. Which brings us to the deepest meaning of the word tzaddik, which is to seek justice. Justice, the kind of justice which Jesus embodied with his very life. The kind of justice which Marcus Borg described as distributive justice. Or as John Dominic Crossan puts it, justice is when everyone has enough. Tzaddik is not an either-or way of being in the world. It's not charity or justice. It's both and, charity and justice. Tzaddik is outrageous acts of generosity, charity if you will, which is, after all, love. Tzaddik is also seeking justice, the kind of justice which concerns itself with distributing the blessings of creation in ways which ensure everyone has enough. Justice, which in the words of Cornel West, justice is what love looks like in public. Charity and justice are not either or propositions. They are tzaddik, a way of being love in the world. Which brings us right back to righteousness. Righteousness, an English word which comes from an earlier English word, right wise. There's wisdom at the heart of righteousness. Holy wisdom herself, the one our Hebrew ancestors speak of as dancing at the birth of creation, the one in whom we live and move and have our being. Let it be said of us that we embody tzaddik, that we seek ways to be generous, charitable, and outrageous in our efforts to serve others, that we are seekers of justice so that all may have enough, that in our efforts to embrace tzaddik, we are right wise in our desire to be love in the world, so that justice may flow down like a river and righteousness flow like an unfailing stream. Let it be so among us. Let it be so. Amen.
Holy One, mystery of love, you are unknowable, except when I gaze at the stars, the glowing Milky Way, the multitude of flowers, trees, and creatures continually unfolding. Then I catch a glimpse of you and how you give endlessly without our asking. In these quiet moments, I long to see more of you, to remain in that sacred space, and I am filled with gratitude and gain a new perspective. My heart aches to see immense suffering throughout our world. India, crying for oxygen, vaccines to put an end to deaths of so many. The desert lands in Africa suffering lack of rain, ravaged crops that threaten famine, the inability to feed their children. Arctic lands watching permafrost and glaciers melt, the ocean warming, hunters unable to chart waters because of weather changes. And here at home, unprecedented heat, wildfires devouring towns, dislocation of hundreds of people from their homes. May compassion push me out of my comfort zone to readily reach out to others. May I enter into the suffering of the earth and hear her cries. May I learn to speak to power, demanding justice. The DNA of all the earth runs in our bodies. May we all join our energies to voice our concerns and find ways to make a difference. As I learn more about our racist history, may the generosity and compassion of Indigenous peoples towards each other, the resilience in their creative ways of making life better, open us to act in solidarity as we walk alongside them. May compassion grow, encompassing me, prodding me ever towards more generosity of spirit. May I give and receive, understand that receiving is also a way to give. May I bow to the holy within all people, within the earth, and know my place in the vastness of creation. May we open ourselves to the examples of Mary visiting Elizabeth when both women were expecting, of Jesus giving up needed rest, speaking to and feeding the multitude, Simon helping Jesus carry the cross, and Veronica wiping the blood from his face. May we have the courageous generosity to stand vigil beneath the modern-day crosses to offer solidarity. Holy One, thank you for your immense generosity. Thank you for the generosity and self-sacrifice of every frontline worker as they continue to keep us safe. Thank you for social workers, women's shelters, telephone hotlines, where women and men listen to the cries of abuse, loneliness, and isolation. Thank you for the hours scientists work to give us a variety of vaccines. Thank you for our gradual coming together once again. May this period of pandemic make us more reflective, provide a new perspective about how to live our lives, realizing that here we live in abundance. May we open to others with great generosity of spirit, realizing that, as the Dalai Lama put it, in fact, taking care of others, helping others, ultimately is the way to discover your own joy.
Show us the way.
always said of us that we embody tzaddik, that we seek ways to be generous, charitable, and outrageous in our efforts to serve others, that we are seekers of justice so that all may have enough, that in our efforts to embrace tzaddik, we are right wise in our desire to be love in the world, so that justice may flow down like a river and righteousness flow like an unfailing stream. Let it be so among us. Be love in the world. May your tzaddik, your righteousness, be blessed by the wisdom of the one who is our lover, beloved, and love herself. Shalom, dear ones. Shalom.
We hope that you have found this broadcast to be of value to you at this time. To continue to offer these, we depend on the support of donors. If you wish to help to keep us going, please donate what feels right for you via Canada Helps to Holy Cross Lutheran Church, Newmarket. Peace be with you.